So I've been using the Mac Mini M1 for about a week now. And a couple days ago, you guys saw the $9,000 Mac Pro versus the $700 Mac Mini M1. And needless to say, everyone certainly had an opinion on that video. If you haven't seen it, I'll let you decide for yourself. You can check it out in the card above, or it will be linked in the description below. But for this video, I want to talk about my overall experience with just the Mac Mini, not comparing it to anything else. And I want to talk about the five things I love about it and the five things that I don't care too much for. Now, right before we jump into number one, if you're new here, welcome. Normally we talk about tech from a filmmaker's perspective. And so if you're into all that latest cameras, gimbals, computers, software, that sort of thing, make sure you hit the subscribe button and give this video a like. Helps me out a ton. All right, let's jump in to the five things I love about the Mac Mini M1. Now, these are in no particular order, but the first one has to go to the speed. I mean, this is what most people have been talking about. This is the reason that I got this computer to test out, was because this is Apple's base model computer, and yet it's outperforming some of last year's mid-tier iMacs and base MacBook Pros and MacBook Airs and obviously the previous generation Mac Minis. Anyone who saw in my last video comparing it to the much more expensive Mac Pro, it can't do everything. So I feel like I need to roll back saying that this computer is magic, because of course it still has its limitations. The reason that I think myself and so many people are blown away by the performance of this thing is because the cost per value for it is just ridiculous. I mean, the task that this thing can handle is just crazy. Booting this computer up, launching multiple programs at the same time, switching between the programs, it's all insanely fast. And it kind of reminds me of a handful of years ago when computers really started switching from traditional hard drives to solid state. And I remember working at Apple in the retail stores and just showing customers like, yes, this one may have more storage, but it's this old type of hard drive. Look at this solid state. And I would just open all the applications at the same time and it'd be crazy fast. This feels like the next iteration of that. It is just crazy how well this thing handles and how well optimized Big Sur is as an OS. It's really generally impressive. And talking about value for the price, that leads into number two, which is the price. The Mac Mini has always been Apple's lowest cost option. However, in the previous generation, they did have a price bump to where you were spending, I believe the lowest base was still like $900 or almost $1,000. And so now they were able actually to bring the price back down to $699 for the base model. Number three, we got the form factor. Now, I've always loved the Mac Mini because it is a desktop computer, but it's one that really can fit on almost any desk and not call too much attention to yourself. It's essentially a giant Apple TV. Unlike the all-in-one iMac, you know, it doesn't come with a screen or anything like that. It's literally just a squared off box. You have your basic IO ports on the back, your power button, and a little very invisible when it's off LED indicator on the front. And of course, your good old black Apple logo on the top. I think it's just a form factor that makes people feel a bit more comfortable and just not like it's being too much. Number four, because of this new M1 processor and a lot of tech nerdy stuff going on in the back end, you can actually fully download iPhone and iPad native apps on here. Now, because it is translating your mouse to simulate your finger, the experience isn't amazing in every app, but it is awesome that if you have one of your favorite apps that you're constantly using on your iPhone or iPad, but doesn't have a Mac version, you can go into the App Store, pretty much search any app and download the iPhone or iPad version right to your desktop. And number five isn't a specific feature, but more of the idea, kind of going back to the fact that this is an accessible machine. The fact that they've lowered the price point while raised the performance of it, I think is a huge win for Apple, because everyone knows Macs are incredibly expensive. And there's a lot of people out there who may have heard from friends that, you know, Macs are better, faster, last longer, whatever. But again, either don't have or don't want to shell out, you know, over $1,000, $2,000, $3,000, whatever, for a MacBook Pro or an iMac. The Mac Mini is the perfect Intro to Mac Starter Computer. And the fact that this was amongst the first wave to get the M1 processor, now people who are trying Mac for the first time can get the lowest cost option. But then when they hit that power button for the first time and everything boots up in under like 5 seconds and all the apps just immediately open when you want them to, new Mac users are going to get that real Apple feeling and not feel like, oh, I'm sad because I got the cheap one. Because like in the PC world, you can go out and buy Razer laptop, whatever. You can buy really nice PCs, but you can also buy really PCs. And now with these new M1 machines, I can confidently say that any new Mac you buy is going to be insanely fast. All right, so I think I put out my fair share of compliments. Now it's time to talk about the 5 things that I am not too fond of on this computer. Number one is the lack of upgrades. And not only am I talking about upgradability that you do after you buy, because that is kind of the Apple norm. Apple's not a very, you know, user customizable friendly company. But even when you're ordering the machine, I get that they wanted to leave power room for the Pro lines that will come out next year, but I really would have loved to see a Mac Mini with a 32 gigs of RAM option. A lot of people are buying this to create content on, and video editors and sound designers making music. And while 16 gigs is okay, borderline pretty solid, having 32 gig option really would have just made this chef kiss of a computer. But again, I get it. They want to save 32 gigs for the MacBook Pros and whatever will come out next year. And you heard me say it a minute ago, this actually does have less ports than the previous generation. What you're losing out on is essentially 2 Thunderbolt 3 ports. So you only have 2 instead of the 4 that you had on the previous generation. And your 10 gigabit port is now a regular gigabit Ethernet port. For the average person, this probably isn't gonna be a huge bummer. You probably don't even know what I'm talking about. But for anyone who was using the Mac Mini as kind of a pro either server or something like that, there is apparently a rumored 10 gig version, but for now at least it's standard gigabit. And for people like myself who plug in a ton of ports, I mean, I have like 6 Thunderbolt devices plugged into my Pro right now, you're gonna need to go with Thunderbolt adapters. And while pretty much every adapter is working, there are limitations like for displays. Instead of having up to 3 4K displays, this one can handle up to 6K display and then a 4K display. So it seems like you can only have 2. Granted, you could use like handoff from an iPad. That is kind of a nice workaround. Number 3, this one will go away with some time, but with all new tech comes an awkward transition time. And so not all software is compatible just yet. Most is compatible from a it will work sense, but not fully optimized. We've talked about Adobe apps, and there's, I'm sure, plenty of other apps that people may be using one off that aren't as popular, but just know that when you go to download it, it may not run as fast, it may not run at all. But just know that if you're not the early adopter type, you may want to wait a little bit to make sure that the software you use is fully optimized. And this one, I personally haven't had any major issues with, just a couple of times, but good old Patrick Tommaso had made a whole video about the Bluetooth issues. The issue is that Bluetooth connectivity from many different devices, mice, keyboards, trackpads, are just really kind of finicky. And from a video editor's standpoint, when you are scrubbing through the timeline or just moving assets around the screen, you really need a smooth mouse experience. The amount of times that your mouse lags from one part of the screen to the other is really kind of just makes you go insane. And number 5, this one may change, and this is only really relevant to people using this as a pro machine, but external GPUs are not working right now. Now, I learned this from Linus's video as well. And to me, that's kind of a big bummer because I could see a lot of people, again, who are on a budget, but they really want to get into video editing or use this as a B machine or an on-set machine. And while it's near perfect, a lot of the bottlenecks that I found, like in my last video, while editing more complex projects, was the fact that, okay, the graphics power is just kind of running out. And so while it does have the Thunderbolt ports that things like the Blackmagic eGPU support, or the Razer Core. Those devices just really aren't being recognized. And obviously I'm guessing that has to do with a compatibility issue between the new software and the M1 processor with the GPUs built in, and all the techie stuff that's going on there is just making it not compatible. I don't know if that's something that can be changed in the future or if eGPUs will have to like change. And so unfortunately, eGPUs, no worky for now.
What's up? So I just wanted to insert this little blip right here as I finish the edit that you're currently watching. Talking about the eGPUs, the other big bummer that isn't supported right now is boot camp or any way to utilize Windows 10. So anyone who is doing it for like leisurely, like you were gaming on the other side of your Mac or anything, or using it for work stuff, developing, coding, whatever, Windows will not work through boot camp. It will not work through Parallels or any other virtual softwares. So that kind of sucks. Not really sure if there's a fix. But anyway, back to the video.
And so there you have it. Those are the five things that I love about the Mac Mini M1 and the things that I don't love so much. To be honest, it was pretty hard coming up with the five things to hate about this computer because, there is no computer that I'm going to say is perfect by any stretch. But to be honest, the way that I look at arguing for the Mac Mini is the same exact way that I argue for my Blackmagic Pocket 6K. You know, this camera has terrible battery life and it's kind of an awkward size and there's a couple cons to it, right? But when you look at the price and what it is actually doing for you, there's no real major competitor or comparison, or you can say like the Mac Mini's fast, sure, but it doesn't have this or it doesn't do this, but you can always fall back on, but it's $699. And so I'm gonna echo the message that pretty much everyone is saying, that hella impressed by what Apple has done with the M1 chip. Cannot wait to see what they do with the Pro lines next year. And for anyone who is questioning whether or not you should buy the Mac Mini or anything like that, let me know down in the comments below what you're trying to use the computer for. And myself or other Mac Mini M1 users, please jump in, start the conversations to see what sort of tasks this computer can handle. And yeah, thanks so much for watching, guys. See you in the next video.